Hi, my name is Ken Pantel, and I'm here today to a discussion around how we measure our economy. And what does it mean to you? I mean, the way we measure our economy determines a lot of how much time we spend in our lives working, how much time we have available for friends, family, social time, creative time, how much time we have to do civic work in our society. So a lot of this is about time. It's also about taking care of our environment, our habitat, you know, the health of our children. You know, it's about the ability to have more equity, gender balance, fairness among men and women in our society, and the importance of that. It deals with a variety of impacts in the world we live in. And the impacts can happen to you where you live, right in your home. And the impact can happen globally. So what we're going to talk about today is the gross domestic product, which is the dominant economic signal on Earth, and the genuine progress indicator, a proposal to replace the gross domestic product with the genuine progress indicator. And the gross domestic product is a measurement that was originally derived in 1934 in the modern era. And basically it was supposed to be a depression era and wartime era measurement. It got carried over and became the dominant economic signal on Earth. What happened was is that it started to become attractive to mathematicians and policymakers as a measurement. And so what happened, the gathering took place in 1944 in Bretton Woods, New Hampshire. And at that gathering, the Allied nations got together just before the World War II had ended. And they were basically devising the global economy. At that time, reinventing it in many respects. Thinking post-World War II is kind of where their head was at. It established the United Nations, World Bank, and International Monetary Fund. And they basically said at that time, the signal we're going to use to compare nation by nation is the gross domestic product, the economic signal, because it had been emerging. It was attractive because it was a measurement that generally measured money exchanges. And those that printed money liked it. You know, basically the money makers. And so for them, it was kind of a signal for their invention, which is the modern monetary system. That was built on the Federal Reserve Act of 1913. So you had the 1913 Federal Reserve Act, and then you had the Bretton Woods gathering as well. And so gross domestic product, it just became a very attractive measurement because it not only dealt in money exchanges, but it also showed the volume of those money exchanges in the economy. It was important because preceding that, there really had been no way to measure the scale of the economy as it was coming out of the late 1800s and early 1900s. The United States and the rest of the world had been growing rapidly. Oil was identified in the mid-1800s as a valuable source of energy. And as we started to learn how to use it more and more, economies accelerated, population started to grow. And a lot of that was tied to the intense amount of energy that oil offered the world at that time. Because a barrel of oil basically could do the work of 500 people. So we accelerated on Earth dramatically at a variety of levels. And population was one of them. Inventions took place. Electricity started on the rise in the late 1800s. So we started to see an incredible acceleration here. And then, of course, the atomic age took over in the mid-40s, and that also helped accelerate. So what we had is this incredible acceleration of volume of activity on Earth, and we had no previous way of measuring that, and the gross domestic product was the way that we could measure, try to create, identify the volume or the scale of activity. And that was the gist, I think, of what we were going for. What's really going on? And how do we measure it? And this was the best way that they seemingly came up with. And of course, I'm sure there were advantages as well for powerful interests that sought to learn how to game this measurement to their advantage. Now, what happened is that the deficiencies in the gross domestic product were being identified by a number of people. The original inventor of it, Simon Kuznets, identified deficiencies in the gross domestic product as a measurement of economic well-being, and many others identified it throughout the years. Late 1980s, mid-1995, eventually what was devised was the genuine progress indicator, a singular indicator that could replace the gross domestic product as a more accurate measurement of overall well-being. So that was where we are today. And so we'd like to do, cutting through a lot of history and a lot of stuff, we'd like to just start comparing the two measurements, because one of the things we're trying to do in Minnesota, for example, but this can be universal. Many countries, for example, have questioned the gross domestic product as a measurement of health and accurate well-being. And it doesn't mean the gross domestic product should be thrown away. The gross domestic product has value. It shows a footprint, but it should not be the dominant economic signal that everyone's chasing on the planet. And so it could be a back burner measurement that you bring out every so often. So we're not saying get rid of it. We're just saying no, use it as the dominant signal that we have to aspire to. In the mid-1990s, Minnesota was looking at alternative economic signals, and the genuine progress indicator rose to the top. And Minnesota did put out a report called Smart Signals. And in that report, they recommended Minnesota move away from the gross domestic or the gross state product, which are synonymous, GDP and GSP. And they move away from that to the genuine progress indicator. Minnesota did do a genuine progress indicator for the state of Minnesota. And at that time, that was cutting edge. But then eventually it got buried and never saw the light of day in Minnesota. But around the world, many countries were also looking at this measurement. So since then, about 30 countries have done genuine progress indicators to test it out in their countries, and they're using elements of it. And then in the United States, about 20 states have done genuine progress indicators, and 4 states have passed it into law. And Minnesota has a bill right now that would offer up an alternative spreadsheet for policymakers using the genuine progress indicator accounting system. So generally, these are the two discussions we're having. The gross domestic product or the genuine progress indicator is the primary signal that we aspire to.
New Hampshire, delegates from 44 allied and associate countries arrived for the opening of the United Nations Monetary and Financial Conference. Invited by President Roosevelt to the first major world financial meeting since the London Conference of 1933, they will work in the seclusion of this White Mountains resort. Zhang Shikong, one of China's representatives, with Secretary and Mrs. Henry Morgenthau. United States Treasury Secretary Morgenthau heads the American delegation. On the opening day, in his role of acting conference president, he addresses the meeting. To be discussed are plans for the stabilization of world currencies. Delegates to this monetary and financial conference pose on the hotel lawn. These meetings are designed to promote trade in the post-war world and to create a foundation for lasting peace.